Hey guys, I'm Mackenzie.
And I'm Hattie.
And this is Study Time's Level 3 strategy video for statistically based reports. Now this standard is kind of like what happens if maths and unfamiliar text comes together. And what this means is that you're going to be reading a lot of unfamiliar situations and having to make some theory or use some theory and concepts that you know to make sense of it.
Luckily for you, the types of questions that they apply every year are actually really, really similar. So if you look through a decent number of past papers and a decent number of practice questions, you should actually be pretty well set to ace this exam.
Let's get into it.
The first thing to think about when you're evaluating a statistically based report is what claim were they trying to make and were they justified in making that claim? So a good example of this is looking at the population that was actually studied and the population that the experiment is trying to make claims about. For example, are they trying to look at all Year 13 students, or are they looking at only Year 13 students in Wellington? For example, if the question said, the experimenter claims that 60% of students overall like study time, but the actual experiment they did was only run on Year 13 students in Wellington, then their sample doesn't match up with the population they're making a claim about, so their claim isn't justified. Might seem like a small difference, but actually has really big implications. The second big part of this is whether they did an experimental study or an observational study. So remember, an observational study is when the experimenter does not allocate the treatments. They just observe and record data about the participants and see how they differ. That will help you find correlations, but you can't find causation by doing that because you didn't cause the treatments and you didn't cause the differences. Whereas an experimental design is when the experimenter randomly allocates treatments to participants, so they can claim that any differences they saw are based on what they did, the treatments they allocated. If you did not do an experimental study, you cannot claim causation.
So the second thing to bear in mind is the overall method used for the study it is that you're analysing. So firstly, think, how were the participants collected? Was it something like self-selection? For the example that Hattie gave earlier, this might not be appropriate because people who sign up for a study about study are probably people who study. So it's not going to be representative of an entire population. Secondly, a really common way of collecting data is by random landline calling, and this is obviously only going to get an older demographic because most people only use their cell phones. Also, something to bear in mind is, how was the information collected? Was something like a survey used? Was a questionnaire used? And so the way that we have to consider these is all the different nuances that come with each of them. So for a survey, people might be a bit biased towards themselves. They might rate themselves better, they might rate themselves worse. These are the kind of things that you should be bearing in mind as well. Also, something like response rate. Now this is how many people actually responded to your call to collect the data. So if not a lot of people are responding, this might also be indicative of either a flaw in the experiment or a demographic within the population that you want to study that is not being analyzed within the sample that you collect. Also, you want to be considering the way the measures were collected as well. So if you are asking people about their study habits a year in the future, they will be very likely to misremember and you might get inaccurate data sets. And also, if you're doing a more experimental style experiment, you might do a time one versus time two. So if you're calculating people's stresses before and after they went into an exam, you could collect the data before and after and calculate the difference between.
Thirdly, you want to consider the strength of the actual numerical evidence presented in the report. So if this is a poll or survey, you're going to be thinking about things like margin of error and confidence intervals. So make sure you're really, really familiar with how these are calculated. The rule of thumb, the way to find the confidence interval for the difference between two dependent samples, and the way to find the confidence interval for the difference between two independent samples. Nextly, remember that the rule of thumb is really only applicable if the survey percentage is between 30 and 70%. Outside of those limits, things become a bit sketchy and it doesn't really hold, and that might be something to mention in your analysis. Remember that when you're calculating a confidence interval for the difference between two groups, if that confidence interval contains zero, then that means you can't make a claim that there's a difference between those groups. That's probably one of the most important things for you guys to remember, and something you might have encountered in your internals as well. For an observational study, you might also be asked to interpret and look at the correlation between the two variables, and sometimes you'll be asked to interpret this off a graph. Remember that the explanatory variable, so whatever one we think might be causing the response variable, goes along the x-axis, and the response variable always goes along the y-axis. You also want to be familiar with what R stands for. So R is the correlation coefficient, and it tells you how strongly related the two variables are. The closer it is to 1 or -1, the more strongly those variables are correlated.
So fourthly, you really want to be considering your limitations. And when you're discussing your limitations, most of these are going to come down to non-sampling error. And so, and to understand what non-sampling error is, we need to know what sampling error is. And this is essentially the natural error that occurs as a result of you using a sample as opposed to the whole population. So the kinds of things that can be non-sampling error are things like confounding variables. And what a confounding variable is it's almost like a third variable that manipulates your outcome that you haven't controlled for and you haven't considered beforehand. So if we were to have a look at study versus performance in an exams, a confounding variable to this might be exam anxiety. And this inhibits a lot of people's performance in an exam despite being prepared beforehand or despite having done a lot of study beforehand. Another thing that can be a big limitation is being careful in extending your results and the conclusions that you want to make outside of the data set that you have. Now, the reason that this is inappropriate is we don't know the kinds of patterns that are visible outside of the data set that we only have. So the kind of things that can be introduced are ceiling effects and floor effects. So we could predict that the more study you do, the higher your score is going to be, but we have to bear in mind that there is a maximum score that somebody could potentially get. So it'd be inappropriate to say, oh, somebody can get 50 points in an exam when really it can only be marked out of 24. So guys, this has been Study Time's Level 3 strategy video for statistically based reports. We've covered a lot, but we haven't quite covered everything.
This one is a hard one to practice for because when you try and look at past papers, they're often copyright protected. So we'd really recommend checking out resources in your workbooks and textbooks, and also checking out the Study Time walkthrough guides. They're available for free online or to purchase in print with next day delivery, and they're designed to walk you through everything you need to know for this exam.
Good luck, guys.